This is a big, big no-no. Like, this is where I would say I would be, if I was the, in an agency side and the client said something about this photo, I would not be surprised.
Hey guys, Ravi here, and I wanted to share this video with you where I gave photography feedback to people and gave them specific critiques to help them improve their photography game. From travel to portraiture to commercial work, there's a lot to learn, and it was great having people submit their portfolios for review. If you're looking to improve your photo game, you can learn a lot from the feedback I give them in this video. So check it out, hit the like and subscribe button, and if you want to see the next live review, check the link below, follow along, and you could be featured in the next one.
What's up, dude? How's it going? We're doing a little creative photography review today. So I don't know if you know, but I'm a photographer, so it's not only games, but doing a little bit of all of it. So this is some of my photography work, and we'll be doing some of that today. A bunch of my Instagram followers sent through their portfolios. We're gonna see some of their work and kind of go through it, talk about what they can improve on, or just kind of see their vibe in general. So it's pretty cool. A little different today. But yeah, here's some of my work. This is in Belize. This is in Norway. Here in Los Angeles, do a lot of photography. This is in Jordan. So a lot of different places I've been. Done shoots for Aston Martin, or sorry, not Aston Martin, Alfa Romeo. And reintroduced them to the U.S. as a brand. Again, more portraiture, travel, photography. This is in Jordan as well. More high-end fashion work doing that, and that's kind of like a bit more what I like to do, kind of integrate the photography, the commercial photography, automotive, and then fashion and landscape. This is kind of all three in one, and this was on a trip actually for AT&T. It was a really fun trip with my friend Jose, who's in town, and Dave, and they're from New York, and we just did this awesome road trip seeing a bunch of stuff. And this is in Oregon, stopping by some of these places for the first time. Oh, this is my friend Scott and Mike. We did a road trip with Jeep, went to some really, really cool locations. We just got to shoot with the Jeep all over the place. It was really, really fun. Jackson Hole, Wyoming. Here in Los Angeles, sometimes there's flowers. It looks like spring here. Kind of amazing. My friend Yelena. And then, yeah, Belize, Jordan, Iceland. So if you want to see more of my work, please feel free on my website here. Different places. Do a lot of work for Nike. Different projects around the world for Nike. Jordan Brand, also under Nike. Definitely check out some of that stuff. If you're ever looking for inspiration or anything else on your career advice, that kind of thing. Again, feel free to scroll down. Lots of travel stuff, lots of fashion. More so on my Instagram, it's mostly travel, lifestyle, fashion, and then a little less commercial work. Commercial work is definitely more on my website, which you can, start to see. And then there's more fashion here as well, which so a lot of this hasn't been posted on social media. A lot of it is kind of for you to discover on here. So feel free to check that out. My man Famous. Nah, dude, I'm just out here trying to give some advice to people who are coming up in the photography game, learning, doing their thing. Bob, what's up, dude? Way to flex. No, not flexing, just kind of showing where I've been, where I've done, it's been a fun journey. So always happy to do more projects, and super fun, just completely different vibes for different projects, but wanted to share some of that. So all right, so that's my stuff. Again, this cat was so playful. It was just perfectly posed in this little spot. I was like, okay, I had to. I don't know if you like cats or dogs. Oh, kangaroos. My girlfriend actually took this photo and this one, all of these. Super cool. That was an awesome trip. I love animals too, so you'll see that a lot in my work, especially if you go to my Africa stuff. That was such a fun trip. Little cubs everywhere. Giraffes, just everything. All right, so Let's get into some of the reviews and see what some of the people who submitted their portfolio. First up, it looks like we've got XCV Andre. I hope I'm... I haven't seen you with your friend Horse in a while. I know, I haven't been hanging out with that many horses recently, but I need to. I love... actually, Patagonia, where else did I see horses? There just aren't that many horses in some of the places I've been recently. I think we saw some in Australia, but not that many. And definitely, yeah, I don't think Africa and Australia, just there weren't that many horses. Gotta get out there and explore some more. All right, so this guy from Ukraine, just a simple guy, nice before and after. So going off of his editing, very cool drone stuff. Before and after, okay, cool. Traveling, this looks like this is New Zealand. The other one was the Cliffs of Moher, I believe. I haven't been there, so I don't know. But yeah, some of his stuff there. Travel photography, some automotive stuff. Some more macro. And nice, I like this little theme of three in a row. Very cool. A little bit of portraiture. It's like some post-snow in there. Post-processed added snow with a cat. Cool, cool. Very glowy. Colors are looking pretty good on here. I like the colors. Really nice work there. But I think a lot of the work is a little... trying to figure out what the composition is. You know, the composition just feels like it might be just kind of, you know, close, but not quite leading the eye to where it needs to go and what the story is. I think you're a little more snapshotty. If that's your style, totally cool. But here, I'm not sure what the story is or what I'm looking for. You know, I think it might be one of those things where you want to focus a little bit more on discovering the story, kind of simplifying the frame, or making it so your specific story is kind of being told. I think that'd be the biggest piece of feedback. Oh, this spot. This is an awesome spot. I love this. I've been there a few years ago, and that's an awesome spot for sure. This one, see, this is simple. I like this. I like the way you've kind of set it up. Obviously, this is classic shot, classic spot in Japan, in Kyoto. But it's just, you know, simple. I think the composition here is classic, but the main thing is, you know, what's your story? And even here, this is simple. I like this frame. Starts to, maybe a little distracting with this window, but I see how you're trying to frame it. And then this is a nice little touch there. So yeah, I think that I would maybe like cut off this side and not have this in. This is pretty nice though. I like the way you're using your lines and your highlights and shadows. This is really nice. So I think focus on more stuff like this where you're kind of drawing the eye in certain directions. My eye goes, you know, down here and then across and over. This stuff I think is just not quite hitting it for me. Maybe if you crop this bottom part off and just kept the top. You know, you cropped it at the bottom there, you'd start to get a little bit more Wes Anderson feel. Something like that. Have a nice stream, brother. Gonna get some games in. All right, CMO, have fun, dude. I'll catch you later for sure. Probably some games at some point for sure. Have fun. I know you're gonna crush it out there. Get some Apex in. Get some dubs. All right, so yeah. Adi, very cool stuff. Really love your... colors are really nice. Again, like the pinks in your highlights, I notice you're using a lot of split toning. Bring those pinks in a little more, like Portra. Really nice greens and things. So keep at it. Again, just simplify it and kind of focus your story. I think that's really important. Maybe, and if you're a digital artist and you want to do stuff like this, adding stars and all that, totally cool. Just kind of what's your focus. This is kind of like shifting in colors and stuff. Super cool per project. And I'm sure that, you know, that kind of stuff could be, maybe that's your move, you know? Kind of focus on that and make it a little more dreamy than the realistic stuff. All right, next up, we got Last Four, Esteban. Someday I'll take a good pick. I like that. Yeah, someday we're all going to take good picks. Until then, we keep trying. All right, cool. So a little more minimalistic stuff. Okay, cool. So I think this is a little bit more novice photography, which is totally, you know, you're kind of learning it, figuring it out. Again, I think that finding your focus and your subject for your composition, this one's really nice. I think this is great. I think that you're telling a great story here. It's always hard. I always have a hard time with beaches and finding the horizon, like what the proper horizon is, you know, which one is it? Is it the angle? Is it, you know, this? It's always tough. So I think that in this case, it might be a little off kilter, maybe rotate a little bit. But compositionally, really nice. This, again, you're doing some, trying some stuff. Totally support that. Some macro stuff or some minimalistic stuff. Very cool. This is starting to get cool and moody. This is unique, but it doesn't feel like what is in frame is simple. It feels like it's kind of just like it's there, like in the way maybe. So be very, very conscious of choosing what's in frame and what's not in frame, why you're having it in frame, you know, what the composition is here. This is actually a really cool moment. I think if you would have moved a little bit to, you know, right now he's just kind of in a random spot in relation to these rocks, but look at your subject, look at each piece in the frame, kind of decide, okay, this piece and this piece are related in that they both have a high contrast. So they're subjects, you know, he's experiencing this rock. That's the story. So is he, you know, he should be a focal point and this should be a focal point. How can you do that? You can either, you know, use the center to actually have them right in one line, or you can move him maybe to this third over here and give this space to breathe. And then your viewer has a chance to look from one third to the middle to kind of this negative space and use this as a much bigger story. So really be conscious of where in relation all of your points of focus are, because that'll help you and tell your story a lot better. For instance, again, back to this one, this, your subjects here, your point of focus, super clear, they're together, that's one point of focus. Then you have all this negative space, which is really nice, gives your eyes room to breathe. And then you have this over here, which tells a little bit more story, that there's not just a flat beach, but it actually leads to a forest, which is really cool. So kind of a little bit of all of it. You want to critique my shitty work? Absolutely, Bob. Absolutely. Anybody who wants me to critique their work, I'm about it. Bring it in. I've got a bunch here that people have submitted and always down to do more. So let me pull yours up real quick as well. I'll have that on there for later. All right, and we'll even pull you into the Discord. Maybe we'll, oh yeah, it's underscore bed. Who's this? Who's this then? How dare they? They took your username. you're gonna just let that happen? All right, so yeah, keep on trying stuff, find your voice, and yeah, I would avoid stuff like this for now. Like, to, you don't need to do like kind of filtery stuff like this to learn who you are and what you want to do. If you want to, if that's your thing, totally, you know, go for it. But, and when you're learning, I think, you know, discover what you're seeing first and then work on your composition and all that kind of stuff. And don't try to make the focus because you used a filter. Make the focus because you took a great photograph that utilized color, composition, contrast, and light. That's way more important. All right, cool. Next is Oscar. I've definitely seen your name before, for sure. I think you are one of my followers that I see quite a bit, and it's awesome. You always leave positive comments, so thank you for doing that. Let's check out your work. All right, you've been to Yosemite, you've been to the Sierras, Kauai, Monument Valley, Grand Canyon, which? Eastern Sierras, got you. Cool. So yeah, traveler, looks like that you live probably in the US. That's my guess anyway. And you go to a lot of the really cool places that I love to go to too, like Valley of Fire, Yosemite. Yeah. Okay, cool. Doing some lifestyle near Joshua Tree. Yeah, this all looks really good. This is cool. Different. You got some architecture in there as well. And I'm not on a super calibrated monitor right now. I'm on my like gaming monitor. So I'm trying to figure out what the blacks actually are. It kind of crushes the blacks a little bit too much, or flattens them rather. But I'm doing my best to kind of make sure that I can see the contrast and I can pretty much tell. But your stuff feels very bright. Very bright. So I don't know, maybe I'll have to check it on a different monitor to see if it's not just this, but a lot of it feels a little washed and bright. Like here I can tell that the exposure, obviously that's a tough exposure because you've got your super bright sunlight hitting this, then you've got it reflecting all over the place, casting these kind of lights everywhere and this different color. Like it's more strong orange here because it's probably bouncing off these rocks and then hitting here, right? And that orange glow from this is amplifying the orange tinge here, the warmth and the color of the light already. So then it kind of filters in and gets more daylight balance down here. But this is a really nice frame. I think that had you maybe shot just a couple exposures, you know, a little underexposed, and then kind of HDR exposures, not necessarily made it look HDR, but shot those exposures so you could bring in some of the detail from this, because right now it's just gone. You should maybe, you know, try doing that next time that you're in a situation with this many varying light levels, and you might be able to pull that back so you can actually tell a little bit more of that story without making it look too HDR, if you know, depending on your taste. And yeah, you'll be able to kind of really nail it then. This drone stuff, very cool. I think these two shots are super similar to each other. Maybe too close together in your feed if you're looking at it that way. You're worried about kind of the way it looks in your feed. You know, just wait a little bit longer, like, you know, three more posts after this and then post it, just so it doesn't, they're not right next to each other. People are like, oh, is that the same shot? Did I already like that? You know, I'm not going to really, but you know, either way, nice shots there. I think I like the composition on this one better, but the story with the car here is really nice. I think that little element adds a lot to it. This is a cool spot. Again, drone, really nice angles. You can always get some nice angles with drones, which is really cool. This is super cool. I think I might have cropped a little bit, like maybe retouched this car out, or you know, waited for this car to come a little bit closer so it's just that one there, one car, and then crop this little piece out, this little negative space, and maybe left a little more sky in so that you kind of had, I think that would have been a little bit nicer composition. Also, this mountain range would have been on this third a little bit nicer. So just focusing on composition is super important. But otherwise, obviously snowy scenes, super simple, almost black and white, really nice, clean work. Bryce Canyon, really nice. Love Angel's Landing. This is a sick spot. Again, I feel like your highlights just get blown out and lost. I think focusing on trying to bring that back with multiple exposures, like I said, or maybe you just need to underexpose a little bit more and then bring up your shadows later, because right now your shadows are plenty bright. You could stand to go a little darker even, I think, but you're very, like, the highlights are just kind of gone. So Bved, thank you for following. Why does this, you just, you know, refollowing, thank you, or were you not following already, just happened to be subscribed. Thanks, Bob. Appreciate it. Again, highlights. I really wish these were in, because this is such a cool shot. Obviously, I love this area. I've taken this photo myself. You got a really great sunset with the glow and the colors, but your highlights are just gone. So unfortunately, yeah, I think that would have made it a lot better overall. Yeah, and okay, so let's talk about your lifestyle real quick. It's interesting because some of your lifestyle stuff, now this is like really kind of moody and dark. This is almost a completely different edit than I've seen in anything else that you've done. Very, very different. Much moodier, much darker, backlit. And then you got this, which is, again, back to kind of lighter stuff. And this one. So her skin tone is like gone, as far as I can tell, right? Her skin tone is just complete white. Which isn't super flattering for models and people. So you want to try to bring that back a little bit, kind of taper off your highlights. I think that'd be one of the biggest things I could say, is bring that detail back. Otherwise, you know, your work's super solid. Places you go are gorgeous. So keep at it and you'll keep developing for sure. Try to find your voice. That'd be another thing. I'm going to say that a lot probably on this stream. Try to find your voice, because I don't think that's something that a lot of people kind of it's not an easy thing to do, but it's a very important thing to focus on. All right. Thanks for submitting, Oscar. All right. Next, we've got picks by Grega. All right. Looks like he's chosen the white border method, and he's into some yoga, travel. Very cool. Shooting with models, traveling different places. I like it. Very cool. All right. Cool. So Grega shooting Fujifilm from Slovenia. Very cool. This looks really clean. You've got really clean work. I think overall that's super cool about it. I think the light you're choosing, the time you're choosing is perfect. Like, this is great. I'm sure this is very commercial, right? You can use this for a lot of different things. If she's using it to sell some, like her yoga studio time, whatever, classes, very easy to do. Really nice. Even here, great moment. I think that missed the focus a little bit, but the moment, I can see why you kept it in. I think your model work is a little bit, I'm not sure what the story is here. Again, that's with a lot of model work. I think knowing what story you're trying to tell, you're capturing one frame out of a full story. So why, you know, what is this part? You know, what is she thinking about something? Why is she against that wall? All that stuff. Just kind of think about it a little bit more, and you'll get a little bit closer to making some really great photos. Sapiro, thank you for following. Welcome to the channel. We're doing some photo review right now. Going through a bunch of portfolios and kind of talking about what people can do to improve their photography, what they're kind of doing already that's great. Like this is really nice. This line right here into these mountains, this composition is awesome. I think that these leaves are, right now they're distracting. I think you could actually use them a little more. Either, you know, move the camera up a little bit so you see more of them to frame it, or lose them completely and it just simplifies the frame. So right now they feel a little like they shouldn't be there, but I think you could have included them more and it would have been, this is sick. This is really sick. This is an awesome frame. Like, I have nothing to critique here. I'll, you know, drop a like on that one. I love that. I think that the only thing I would say is that this bottom piece right here might be where this starts to get bright again. Just, you know, loses a little bit, but overall, great shot for sure. Again, I like the poses and the things that are going on. It just, like, why is she doing that? Why, you know, what is the, it just feels posed, right? It doesn't feel like it's part of a story. So the inauthenticity of it is the only thing I would say to make sure you check out, work on. Try to get more of an authentic moment rather than, like, this one's pretty cool if you were to, like, just crop into her face. I think this, the rest of it's not as interesting, but this, the hair in the face and that, like, that says something, right? It's almost a story right there. Try some stuff where maybe it's not always the same kind of head to shoulders. And this, it's hard. I think just study some modeling poses and kind of try to figure out how to shoot with them a little more like a story. Yeah, cool. All right, thanks for submitting, Grega, and we're gonna keep moving along. Artikash. All right, Artikash. Here we've got, all right, a lot of travel. Very cool. Art Akash. I get it now. That's what it is. My dad follows you. That's awesome. Okay, so my dad likes your stuff. I mean, that's you got a vote of confidence right there already. That's big. I don't even know why he follows me sometimes. I'm just like, I'm impressed, right? He's the one that gave me my camera, so you know he has good taste for sure. Cool. You travel all over the place, dude. That's sweet. This is crazy. Look at that, Gujarat. Wow. Very cool. So, wait, where are you? California, Arizona. Very cool, dude. This is a great image. I think the only thing about this image that I critique would be the composition here and maybe the contrast of kind of the sky. Overall, really great. Love it. Colors. I mean, hard to go wrong in Arizona. Kind of this moment is amazing with all these horses. Like, really, really amazing. I think it would have been stronger had the horses been over here. Just to kind of, so you would have just taken some steps to the right if you could. I don't know what, you know, the situation is, if there's bushes or trees and you can't get it. But if you were able to have the horses here, it would have been a really strong image, because you would have, you know, made a little more harmony and balance in the image with this shape and this kind of heaviness. And then this would be your next subject. So those two would play off each other really nicely and balance the image. And you'd have your negative space almost like a yin yang kind of situation. Would have been really cool. That would be the main thing with that image. Really love this kind of long exposure stuff. Really nice. Kind of simplifies the frame. Again, I think just focusing on your composition, that's the main thing I would look at with this kind of, with your photography right now, I'm noticing, is kind of compositionally, it's very unique. Like this little patch of road right here. That's cool. Here, it just doesn't quite feel, it feels a little more balanced because of this cloud, but this, it almost feels like unbalanced in a lot of your photography. That's the one thing I would say. This is nice. That works really well. So that's really nice too. I think, again, had the mountain been here, if you would have taken some steps to the left and it would have been kind of balanced with the buffalo and mirroring the shape of this mountain, or like, you know, yeah, exactly, mirroring one on top, one on bottom, that would have been really strong. So definitely check that out next time, just kind of thinking about your composition and how your subjects relate to each other. That's I think this one, again, I think if you would have lowered your camera a little bit and moved a little bit to the right, you would have had him perfectly in that third, and also the mountains would have lined up a little bit lower to him, so he and the horse are not conflicting with this horizon line. And you would have seen this, like, right now he's blocking some of this great mountain range. If you would have lowered yourself, moved to the right a little bit, he would have been in this perfect gap, and the horse head would have been above as well, and him, and you just had to get a little lower to the ground, that would have been an awesome shot. It would have had really strong compositionally, the elements, everything would have worked together. Right now I think you have him centered, and kind of this is conflicting with him, and then this line is conflicting with the horse. So just kind of just shifting a little bit in your composition, you're going to have a lot stronger images overall. Other than that, I mean, you're getting out there, you're doing it. Here's that kind of that example of what I was just talking about, where it doesn't feel like it's conflicting. Here it feels like this horse is as big as these mountains. It's really cool. So that's an awesome moment, an awesome kind of I don't know, just feeling that this is something different. So very cool there. Oh, this spot. Oh, this is a really cool spot at Taft Point. I saw that too, that slack lining. These guys are insane. The fact that they get up there and they just slackline across, I don't know. I want to do it, maybe, but it's wild. That's a great moment. Nice. Santa Cruz. Very cool. Here, I'm not sure what the composition is trying to do here. This is kind of conflicting with this. I see the people. I don't know. It's kind of like moving the camera up or just getting slightly different composition. This is a tough one. It's kind of a lot of stuff's conflicting for me, so I would say that would be one I'd work on, you know, just focusing on your composition, and again, kind of rehashing what I've said before about your work. But really nice otherwise. This is really beautiful. I waited a little bit longer so that the duck or goose or whatever was right here, would have been a little bit stronger, just kind of, again, giving it space from all these other big objects and things. This piece over here, if it was a way to like just shoot this rock solo, or these two rocks without touching the edge of frame, and then the, you know, the bird here, I think that would have been really nice. That would have made a really great frame, because right now this feels like it shouldn't be here, this feels cut off, this feels like it's conflicting, you know, just looking at all of that and trying to see separation and simplicity in all of your stuff, I think you'll improve a lot if you do that. So cool. All right. Thank you for submitting, Akash. Appreciate that a lot. And we will move on to the next person. All right. Let me know again if you guys have any questions or want to see anything in chat as well. Please feel free to drop a follow, comment, whatever you guys want, and we'll definitely check out your work too. Next, we got Artur the bot. Getty Images Creative. Cool. So here we've got more travel, which is awesome. Love the travel work. Ooh, cat. Istanbul, Jordan, Amman. Okay, cool. This looks like a set of stairs I saw in Istanbul. And there's cats everywhere there. So that's why I was like, oh, maybe. Okay, so some digital art as well. I think I saw, yeah, there was something about this style recently, like a tutorial that went viral or something like that. So a lot of people probably trying stuff like that. More digital artwork. Cool. This is beautiful. That's really nice. See, this is an awesome shot right here. Obviously, Italy, it's a very gorgeous area. The Italian Alps, the Dolomites, very, very beautiful. So hard to go wrong there, but this moment and the exposure is all pretty perfect. And you still get the Alps, is it Alps de Suisse? Seda? Oh yeah, I don't know. But that's great. Yeah, you can already tell that. Again here, blew out the highlights a little bit. I know this is your subject. I would just try to not, you know, underexpose a little bit more so you can still bring this out. But this up here, just losing that highlights, it's tough. It's tough to, you want your subject to be able to see, or you want to be able to see that and your subject. So it's kind of like roll your highlights off a little bit rather than just like blowing them out completely. Again, here it's like these clouds are just blown out. Roll it off or try to figure out a way that they're not, you know, feeling like this exposure is so much different than, you know, these shadows and stuff, without going to HDR, of course, unless you're trying to do that. More kind of artwork, which is cool. I think your colors feel a little flat to me, and that's obviously, colors are very one of those things that I'm known for. It's kind of like what I love to look for in things. I think that I'm just feeling like your colors maybe could use a little more love to make sure you're getting what you want out of it more stylistically. Otherwise, yeah, it's a little too true to life. Or digital, you know, that digital kind of color that you get out of certain things, and it just kind of comes out of the camera and you look at it and you're like, wow, this looks digital. Doesn't have any like kind of that magic little touch to it. I think that these might have a little bit, you could go a little ways, you know, getting out of this space. This looks like it's maybe shot on an iPhone. I'm not sure, something low res, but yeah, just play around with your colors a little bit more. Like this has some mood to it. So I don't know about the watermark, but everything else, a little more mood to it, a little more kind of feel. I know I'm probably going way too far back and you're just like, don't go that far back in my portfolio. but yeah. Yeah, similar kind of stuff. Like colors here are nice, but you know, that's kind of just too much like a snapshot to be considered something I would say is like a photograph that you were aiming for, you know, kind of just took it. So yeah, cool. The color of that water is nuts. That's insane area. Very cool. That color of that water. I want to go there right now and swim in it. Awesome. Very cool. All right, Arthur, thank you for submitting. Next we have Daniel, who's DGSC. Okay, I see this guy all the time. I don't know this guy in person, but always see his comments and things and really appreciate him hanging out. And yeah, let's check out some of his work. So outdoor commercial, start with the outdoor. All right, awesome. Wyoming, Washington, California coast, Sierra Nevada. Already I can tell, love your colors, love kind of your softness in your work. Let's go to California coast because we're in California right now. Very cool. Love the light. Quality of light's great. Lens choice, nice and wide. Really, really nice. Love that little moment. Super simple, super clean. Again, like, you could keep this in if you want. You could simplify it and cut it out. It's really up to you. I love this spot. Gorgeous shot here the other day. Love the colors you got going on and the light, color, quality of light. Really nice. This one's great because you kind of get that story. Oh, I don't know if I can go back. Yeah, there we go. You kind of get the story. Got some great conditions in this one for sure. Hawk Hill. Really, really nice. I want to go to Cali now. Really, for sure, dude. It's insane. You do this little road trip. This is SF, I think. It's still part of SF. This is, yeah. Look at that. That's California has everything. Really nice colors. Crushing it. Let's see. Let's try something. So I think your travel and your... I can already tell that your landscape stuff is on point. Loving this. This is awesome. Awesome composition. Love where you place the subject. Really nice. Again, see, you're kind of taking, what I was saying earlier. I think that you could crop in from the right on this one a little bit, but overall, compositionally, you're using your subject kind of to against your other subjects, the other composition. So super strong there. Reflections for days, a lot of reflections. Diversity of subjects, maybe the only thing, or adding a story to it, but really great work overall. Really great on your landscapes, dude. Very cool. Let's go to your commercial work. All right, let's see. So this is where a lot of times it's hard to kind of transition for a lot of people from doing really great commercial or really great travel work, and then they kind of go in and start adding, you know, asked, hey, we love your landscape, we love this, let's get us the commercial work in there, let's get some subjects, let's get some whatever it might be, so that you can, you know, try to add more. Hold on 1 second while I'm gonna add these people. They came in late. All right. All right, cool. Add a few more people in here. All right, back to Daniel's work. Very cool. So, not everything. I'm not there. You could be, though. This is on you. You had plans to come to California, and then you chose to just B21 not in California, which sounds terrible to me. I don't know why would you should just come right out here. So let's see, work for Cashy, Trumer, Perfect Bar, a lot of travel companies, it looks like, a lot of kind of hiking inspired, Keen, and then Tequila, which is maybe also hiking inspired, depends where you're going. So let's start with, usually you put like the top few that you really love as your first few, so people check him out. So let's check out his top view first. All right, again, worked on letting you go outside to do things you love. Cool. So I think I'm already kind of noticing that you're using a pretty wide lens here. It's like 24. It could be even wider than that. Actually, yeah, it's wider than that because this cache box is distorted. So yeah, it's like 16, right? 16-35. Probably your go-to lens, I would guess. 2.8 or 24. Yeah, it looks like. So yeah, I mean, overall, the quality of light is still great. The story elements are starting to come in, which is really nice. You're able to place your subject. However, I think with a lot of landscape photographers and travel Instagram type, you know, you've got these great images and things that work there, but then when you go to the commercial world, you start to you don't quite notice the little things that someone with more trained eye might have. More trained meaning they learned more standard photography, they were more traditional, and that is kind of some of the distortion. God, your camera is nice. Thanks, dude. Actually, I just realized I have to make sure to check the battery on it. Okay, we're good. Thanks, dude. Appreciate that. I'm getting lights, I think, not tomorrow, but the day after. So I should have some light as well. Hopefully we'll get more lights. So it's primo. I want to be able to, you know, get some nice. Right now, I'm just literally using what I have in my house with daylight and everything else. So, all right. So here we've got an example where we're starting to get some of the distortion. I think that, you know, little perfection things like this fold in the blanket, normally it would be kind of one of those things where it would be not tremendously a thing, but in commercial work, you have to think of everything. You have to look at every little piece and everything has to be kind of perfect. So if this were to go somewhere that they're going to use commercially, you have to really look at that and make sure it's legitimately like perfect, perfect. So this fold, I would have, you know, worked on. Placement of the spoon is interesting. Obviously, this fold might be, all this kind of stuff's fine. But right now, this is maybe, this could use some dodging and burning to really draw out the product and the kind of subject, what's going on, to really focus your attention on it. Here, this is a big, big no-no. Like, this is where I would say I would be, if I was the, you know, in an agency side and the client said something about this photo, I would not be surprised. And that is that the box is distorted at the edge. And this makes the product look not as premium as it could be, which is what a lot of clients want, right? So they want a premium, perfect, awesome, looks like a render. And sometimes it is. Most of the time in a lot of product photography, a lot of photography you see, it looks, you know, that next level of render. So here, this one right here, I would say this is this would be something I would work on. I know it looks like you might have, you know, brought the highlights back on the box. Oops. Maybe not, but it's a little hard to read. I don't know if that mattered to the client or not, but just having it in the background. But commercial work is tough because the brief is always different, what the client's looking for. If this goes on your Instagram feed, then maybe it doesn't matter because it's just in the background and that's all they care about. But if it's on their Instagram feed, it might matter. Yeah, it really depends on the brief. Next up, we have this shot, which again, just telling the story, which is awesome that you were able to get multiple angles for them. I think that's super key. Really great job on that, making sure that you got multiple angles. Same background, so gives you a lot of options for the client to decide like how much product they want. Here we go. This is another example, distortion. So you're probably on a 16 here and he's in the corner. And there's really, really rough distortion right here. You'd want to, you can do this, but then you have to go and you liquefy and push this back in so it's a little more normal of a kind of proportions, because you can just see that distortion stretch, and you don't want that again with clients. This headlamp onto the product, onto the subject, really nice touch. Most people wouldn't even notice that probably, but great job, you know, making sure that that's lit so that people can focus on that. It's not just a dark shadow. They actually see the detail of the cereal and all that kind of stuff in there. So really great touch on that for sure. Same thing here. Great job. Highlight again. And this one, you can't see the subject at all. I don't know if the client cared or not, but that would not be one that would pass most agency work. You'd have to, you know, figure out a different way to hold it or something that actually showed the product off a little bit more. Again, here, this would probably pass more so far away, but yeah. Yeah, great work on that campaign for sure. Look at some Pilsner, Trumer Pilsner. Great moment with them. The light, they're able to, you still got them separated. I think his head might be a little close to the horizon. It's a little conflicting right here. So I don't know if that means raising the camera up a little bit higher. You know, again, this is like being kind of blocked by him. There's just conflicting things right now. I think also maybe too wide of a lens. I would have gone maybe a little bit tighter on the lens, backed up a little bit. And I would maybe gone, you know, 35 or even 50 and just really had a nice kind of frame with them in it. So it didn't feel so, they feel really far apart. They feel like they're, even though they're close together physically, just because of the wideness of the lens and how close you are, they feel like this moment isn't as kind of like close as it could be. For a lot of commercial work, you want your subjects to feel like you're evoking the emotion that they want. And again, the distortion here starts to widen them. And I'm sure that they, you know, most models and people don't like to be wider than they are. But this kind of wideness of the lens does that for sure. Here's a little bit tighter. I would have maybe retouched this little rock out so you could focus on this because it's distracting. Again, same thing here. This rock is distracting right now. If you would just, I guess you'd have to raise the camera again and then you could still see the rock below, or lower the camera so this isn't conflicting, or move your subjects is another way to do it. And then also maybe go in and just really use like a clarity brush or something, just give you a little extra punch on the product to make it come out a little bit more. Here again, I can see a lot of similarity in the way you shoot your subjects, shoot your kind of stories. You get this, you know, couple of close angles like this, and then you do walking with the product. His pose right here and her pose, I think they're a little, especially his, like, doesn't feel comfortable. I think you have to practice that motion back and forth. I've had to do a lot with Nike, for instance, when they're professional runners or athletes. They have to do this motion. They're super good at it. They know what they're doing. Obviously, he's probably walked before. It's just a guess, but I'm not, you know, 100% sure. You have to make sure that your subject has a few opportunities to do it so they look natural doing it, because once you're told, like, okay, you have to walk, you all of a sudden forget how to walk. It happens all the time. Like a model, professional athlete's like, wait a minute, I completely don't know how to run anymore, even though I do it for a living. So then you have to do the motion a few times, kind of get back into it, and then you can nail that moment where he looks comfortable. You tell your story, you know, they're walking back up the cliffs after having some beers. Really clean, but at the same time, this kind of, there's some distraction. I don't know. It doesn't feel as, something about this doesn't quite sit right with me as a product shot. I like that you chose, you know, a unique creative angle where it's on the edge of a hill rather than flat on something, but I don't necessarily feel like this is the strongest composition from you. I think you could have maybe chose, you know, different spot. I know you're probably in a rush to just get it with the light being good, but so this is a great image except for him. I think you needed to crop him out or not have him in this, or retouch him out afterwards or something. Everything else about this is awesome. I think this rock formation would have been awesome if it was over here. Probably not possible with the way everything's set up, but you know, the birds, super cool. Everything about this is great, except for this is super distracting to me. And obviously, it would be awesome if this was over here instead. But, you know, whether that's possible or not, yeah, I don't know. But this definitely just makes the image feel like it's not professional. Feels like a snapshot. But this would feel like a timeless image if you just had that. They could use that for a long time, I think, with their marketing. This is a great shot. I think the way she's holding it is a bit strange. She's kind of just like holding it out rather than maybe in her other hand she could have been just holding it, or both hands, something to because nobody just kind of holds their beer like this. Just think about like more natural moments. And of course, I'm sure you're shouting at her from, you know, across, and the waves are really loud and it's really hard to kind of communicate that, but, and she's trying her best holding it different ways. But yeah, just something to think about, authenticity when it comes to a lot of commercial work. I think that gets lost even in the commercial work you see all over the, you know, the world, and billboards. There's a lot of the inauthenticity. Just makes you look at it and go, that's not real. Why do I care about that product? I'm not gonna buy into it. This is great. Okay, Sutro, very cool. I haven't been there in a long time, so I don't even remember what it looks like. But yeah, this is great. Again, the contrast I think could be a little bit more simplified so that you're really focused on this area, but overall, really great composition. Maybe just retouch these birds out right here, this little section, so that you can, you know, it's not touching the edge. It's a little distracting. Otherwise, really great. The light wasn't quite as strong yet, or it had already gone down, so it's it's a little flatter than your other images, but if it would have been a little bit more light coming through, I think you would have nailed it a little bit earlier, probably before the sun went down. Longer lens stuff, I think, is a little different for you, trying to figure out where the in-between is. But your longer lens stuff is, it's a little tough right now. I think the composition is decent, but there's a lot of kind of uncomfortable negative space. Simplifying your subject and just kind of focus on the product. So I would work on that a little bit, but really nice overall. And I've spent a long time on your portfolio, dude, but I think that you have really great work. And I think that, you know, just pushing it a little bit farther, your colors are awesome. The light's really cool. Love the way you're kind of utilizing everything. Just push it a little bit further and you could be in a more commercial world. I think right now it still feels a little travel-y, a little Instagram-y, but like this one, right? Again, not to harp on the same subject, but so 1635 you got right here with really, really rough distortion around the edges, and you just don't want that when it comes to products. You want to make sure that your product does not look distorted. Otherwise, the client will just automatically reject the image no matter how great it is, and that's a really important thing to think about. Kind of throughout all your work. Otherwise, great. This image is really strong. The light in this one's not as amazing, but it still gets the job done. It's really cool. Like, the light here is nutty, obviously, you know that. And yeah, some really great work otherwise. Wow, you did a long road trip to get all these places. I hope it was a fun road trip. It looks like it was a good time. Cool. All right. Any other questions in the chat right now? All the 9 people hanging out. If you guys have any questions about the work, or, you know, again, we're doing photography review, portfolio, kind of going through people's stuff and yeah, talking about that. So we'll move on to the next person. Very cool, Daniel. All right. Ishan Gupta, studying computer science and philosophy and doing passionate about photography. And amplifying human experiences with AI, especially in the creative space. Interesting. AI in the creative space. Huh. That sounds cool. I don't know what that means. But yeah. All right. Going to some cool places. You got Yosemite. Eye for Black and White. It's a cute dog. Some concert photography. So you kind of have a lot of different kind of things going on. DFDK. Timed out. What's going on, Bob? What happened? I didn't even see it. Sorry, I misclicked. What did DK say? I didn't even see it. It didn't show up on my chat. I asked Asmius. What was your question? Dude? If you want to ask again, go for it. For some reason, I didn't even see it. He asked if you were Asmius. Yeah. That was my gamer tag. For a little while, yeah. I swapped everything over though to just my name. Yeah, it's all the. I don't have this. I want this username on Twitch and everything else, but for some reason right now, did a terrible job at the rebrand. What do you mean? The rebrand's great. Are you kidding me? It looks great. The rebrand is what's up. You mean I just did it like fly by night, didn't tell anybody, and I just rebranded? Yeah, I did do that. But that's kind of what I wanted to do anyway. Why you stopped streaming? I didn't stop streaming. I just stopped streaming PS4 stuff because I'm doing PC now. So PC, doing games, and also doing some photography stuff as well. So a little bit of both. Right now we're kind of reviewing photography portfolios. So you can see my work here. I know a lot of the gamer friends that I have don't really know that I do photography. Oh, you didn't see Asmius. I see what you're saying. Yeah. Now we're doing it under this name, which is the correct name that I wanted in the beginning, except for the underscore. But yeah, I do a lot of photography as my main job. So a lot of this stuff is, you know, sharing kind of what I'm doing and Beautiful work, though. Thank you so much. Appreciate that. Yeah, this is, you know, when I'm traveling a lot and then come home, play some games sometimes with friends, and this is going to be like a little bit of both while we're streaming it. So, yeah, feel free to check it out. PC Master Race. Okay, Bob. Okay. All right, so Ishan Gupta. Hope you're well, doing well, DK, for sure. Check it out when we do play, you know, PC games. Definitely playing some Apex. Plan to get to Predator on PC as well, not just PS4, even though PS4 is still the first love. Be playing with my boys, actually, the new, what game is it, Bob? The Modern Warfare, right? Modern Warfare? I think that's what it is. The new Call of Duty, whatever that is. Playing with them a little bit, for sure. Stream that. All right, Ishan Gupta. Very cool. The minimalism is actually really nice. Gotta love that spot. I think it looks like you have maybe, you know, either you're uploading in a little bit lower resolution, or it's a lower resolution camera, kind of a starter camera, which is totally fine, because at this point you're just figuring out composition and everything. This is beautiful work, though, honestly. You're figuring everything out. Composition is great here. You've got your leading line here that reaches your subject, and then you got another leading line that comes over here that balances it out. You know, with a little more retouching, I think some of these dark spots and things will be closer to a commercial image. Same here, really nice that you kept the heaviness of the image down here and then left all this negative space for the eye to breathe. The birds up here, this is a great composition. I think you're actually doing really great stuff here. I think your eye for composition is on point. Color looking really nice. Here's select work 3. Cool. Yeah, I think really solid composition, actually, overall. I can't click on these, unfortunately, but Drummer Luke 36, thank you for following. How's it going? How's your day going? We're just doing some photography review here, seeing people's portfolios, talking about composition and things like that. Luke Skywatcher. Oh, cool, dude. Yeah, we'll pull you up right after this. How does that sound? I'll pull it up right now. Luke Skywatcher. Sweet. Pull you up after this. Or at the end of this. So we've got a few in front of you, and then we'll do it at the end for sure. So stay tuned and you see some of the other people on the way, and then we'll get to your stuff for sure. Alrighty, Sean. So basically, yeah, keep up the good work. Do a lot. I want to see more photography from you. It's kind of hard to tell just kind of from this, but I think that your eye and, you know, you're developing your work. You know, a body of work is the hardest thing to really create and craft, but I think that your composition is really your strongest part. So keep shooting some black and white if that's what you love to do, if that gets you, you know, a stronger composition. And then I think your color work is actually, you know, similar, right? It's bottom third, bottom third, bottom third, bottom third in a lot of this, but it's still solid. So keep working on it, try different subjects, expand your work, and hopefully you'll go from there. Thanks, man. Glad to follow along. Yeah, thank you, dude. Glad you're here hanging out. All right, next up we have Divyesh. Again, I might be butchering people's names. I'm sorry, I'm doing my best. This guy is, I don't know where you're from. I can't really tell, but very cool. So, Rajkot, Asian paints, Jaipur. So India, most likely, which is super cool. India, I've been to India 3 times. Three times, twice? I don't know. And every time, like, just so beautiful there. I took a camera there, and it just kind of opened up my eyes to a lot of the street photography, and you can kind of point your camera in any direction, and it just looks really good. I should post some of my old India photography, because it's kind of insane. Just, hold on, I'm going to see if I actually can find some of it real quick on. Okay, well, this is not it. Let's see if I can find even one photo. Here's one photo. So this photo, where is this? On Pinterest. Somebody. Okay, well, I don't I have a Pinterest account. I'm sorry. Yeah, there's some India photography that I've done in the past that is, I'd love to find that again. There's one. Dang, this is some old photography. Anyway, yeah, so we'll check that out. At some point, I'll go through and review my old work and tell you how bad it is. Don't worry. I was never, you know, I grew a lot since then, but such a cool place to shoot. All right, so here's, looks like a lot of different things. I can see, you know, some of the influence you've got going on. You know, this is actually really interesting. This is super cool, like minimalism subject. This is starting to get into a cool space, I think. Honestly, this is really cool. I think focusing on a little bit more minimalism for you, this isn't as strong. I think some of the, if you're focusing on minimalism, like even this feels stronger, right? I know that India is very chaotic and busy, but I think that finding the minimalism in it is one of the most beautiful parts. I think there's a lot of photographers that go over there and find places and things to shoot, and they find the minimalism in the chaos, and that's what actually makes it feel super strong. You know, stuff like this, right? You got this, all this stuff going on, but you able to capture that with a motion blur tracking shot and capture that, or, you know, these patterns and these colors and things. You know, finding that is super strong. So I would focus on some of that, finding those moments and those things, developing your style a little bit more of who you are, what you want to shoot. Because right now you're kind of got quite a bit of variety, which is great, but it doesn't feel cohesive. This feels like it could have been shot by a different photographer from, you know, some of your other work. Right now I don't see it coming from one place necessarily. I see it from many places. So keep shooting what you love. Keep working on figuring out what light and, you know, compositions and colors that you like. But definitely try to find a little more simplicity. You know, even in the patterns here, that's super cool and interesting. But let's say you have this. Great shot architecturally, but then maybe you put a subject here or something, you know, something simple. Spetty Sanchez, thank you so much for following. Welcome to the stream. How's your day going? We're doing some photography review here and just kind of cruising through people's work and seeing what they're about. Going well. Good to hear it, dude. Yeah. Going through a bunch of this stuff and critiques. Not so much critiques as just kind of reviewing. I guess you could, yeah. Just kind of seeing it for what it is, giving tips on how I would improve if I were in your shoes, what you're kind of looking at. I think a lot of it is really, it's you can take it as a critique, you can take it as kind of just advice, you can take it as, you know, a bunch of stuff you don't even need to listen to. But I think it's actually, if you want to work as a photographer, you know, develop your craft, if you want to find a commercial space, you know, that's kind of the aspect I'm coming at it from, but also kind of in the mind of what artistically are you trying to, you know, tell with these photos. So yeah, what is your story? Like, I don't know what the story here is, what the moment is. I'm sure it's cool space, but I'm very lost as to what you're trying to tell people with this shot. So that's what I would say, is kind of just try to figure out what the story is and what is going on and the emotion you're trying to evoke. So yeah. All right. Next person. B-Ved, are you here? Here, let's pull you up in Discord so you can defend yourself. Bob, are you here? Here, pull, how do I invite you into this channel? Instant invite. Copy this. Offline, you're offline right now. Yeah, we've done quite a few. I'm gonna send this to you. See if you pop in here or not. We've done quite a few reviews, but if you have yours, I think we can definitely fit you in. We've done quite a few already, and we've had some really great entries. Check them out and given some feedback, and I hope that everyone's kind of enjoying it. But also, if you have any questions or whatever, just let me know. I think it's Very cool that people are submitting what they've got going on. All right, so we're here, and B-Ved, I just want to make sure he's here for this, because if he's not here, you know, then he was just in the chat. Let's see. We'll move on to... Oh, there he is. Okay, good. He's here. Hi. Let me delete a bunch of stuff before I submit. Okay. Okay. Yeah, for sure. Do it. Bob, you ready for this? Okay. First of all, this is not California. That's the biggest mistake. Coney Island? Is that a... Is this trying to be like Santa Monica? Or I don't know what this is. Yeah. I think this needs to be California. Then it would be lit. All right. So a lot of event stuff. Music. I'm at the store, so no Discord. All right. Fine. Then you just have to listen and take it. Portraiture, you got a little travel, you've got a little cats, more portraits, events. Okay. All right, so oh wow, that's the end of your portfolio. Okay. I think since I know him, I'm going to be a little more honest with him. Well, not honest, but just more in depth. More in depth with him. Okay, so these are kind of cool. These are kind of cool as a series. I know I don't post a lot. You should post more. There's one critique. There's one review right there. You should post more. shoot more. Always shoot more, because you're going to develop your craft. You're going to figure things out a lot better. You're going to make more mistakes, which I love making mistakes. That's one of my favorite things ever, doing weird stuff and then trying to figure it out from there. I would say that's going to help you grow a lot. Right now, a lot of this stuff, actually, you feel like you're moving in a direction. This is awesome. I think that this is one of your... really nice, like this is a really nice moment. You got this kind of wave going on, you've got all of this happening, and her emotion, I think, is an awesome image. This is the strongest one I've seen in your portfolio yet, for sure. Yeah, I would say this is definitely your strongest image, and I would focus on maybe doing more stuff like this and keeping that emotion. You've got her looking off here to camera, but it's following this line here, which keeps this negative space, and that leads you to her. The soft focus helps a lot, obviously, looking at your subject, leads down to here, and then you got this highlight on her hand, which is another third. So you've got these two kind of points of contrast that really bring out your whole image, so that there's something to look at. And then this negative space here kind of fills in here the balance. Really, really strong image from your portfolio, for sure. I think definitely your strongest that I've seen. This is another strong image, but I think that the model's doing more work than the photo is, if that makes sense. I think you're just relying on her, you know, kind of just natural good looks, but not really telling much more of a photography story. Beauty shot, great, awesome, if that's what you want to do. Here, again, I think you have maybe a missed opportunity with some emotion. Right now, she just looks like she's kind of just there. I love the depth you've created with these, you know, foreground subjects and all that, creating that depth and that focus. But maybe had she been like leaning her head on there, looking at you, or I don't know, just a moment of something. The story right now just feels like she's staring off in a weird space direction and doesn't feel like it's really telling me too much. But I think that there's something that could have been there. You know, if I, you know, pull up that other image, compare it, the emotion is just night and day. This gives me an emotion. The other one, yeah, it just has nothing, like it's flat, and I don't think it's necessarily doing any favors emotionally, but obviously it's a clean image. Open to all genres or travel portraits? Open to all genres. Yeah, anything. Yeah, photography, definitely nothing is off. We're just looking at all this stuff. Just send me your Instagram link, and we'll look at it for sure. Who's this guy? Drone, that's cool little moment. This is nice. I think that you're, you know, you get into a space that's like a little more painterly with this, which is cool. But I think that it doesn't, and the pose is nice too. You know, all that kind of works really well. That's pretty nice. The event stuff, I feel like it's cool that you're shooting it and it's like there. I have a really hard time with event stuff. Like having a really amazing image is like, I've described this before, but it's, you know, you've got a photographer who's an artist and you've got an artist on stage. What is that connect? There's no connection there. You're shooting somebody who has no idea. You're just a stranger in the crowd to them. They have no idea what you're doing. So there's not a collaboration. Like they're doing their thing, which looks cool, and you have to capture the right moment and everything, but you're doing all the work or they're doing all the work and you're just snapping it. So you're either snapping it of something they already set up and it's theirs, or you're doing all the work and you're making and crafting a moment based on what you know or like discover in the moment and get lucky with timing. So event work is one of those things where there's a very, very strong disconnect for me personally to make sure that this is amazing. This is so good. Unless you know, maybe have seen the show before, capture the moment. There's some really great event photographers, friends of mine, you know, they study and know what's going to happen. They get the different shots from different places, get really lucky sometimes in the right place, right time. But yeah, event photography is one of those very, very, it takes a lot for me to be super impressed. Because otherwise it's just like, is this just a snapshot? If you just happen to have access, is it access? Is that the key ingredient to good photography, event photography? Or is it, you know, actually crafting a moment, thinking of it, being an artist, and that isn't always access. I don't know. I'm partial to a lot of that, and that's why I don't shoot a lot of it. I shoot a lot of, you know, lifestyle around it, and I'll shoot with the artist off stage or, you know, in different kind of moments to create something, but not always shooting someone on stage in their environment and I'm just a stranger in the crowd to them versus a connection where we're collaborating together and they know and they're vibing off what I'm doing and I'm vibing off what they're doing, if that makes sense. Here's the color version of that shot. Okay, it actually works better in black and white only because I think maybe your color grading is a little flat there. Again, I'm not on the calibrated monitor, so maybe it's awesome. I just can't really tell. But yeah, I think that exploring some other stuff, some more elements integrating. This is cool. This is a great moment. You waited for this. You saw this before it happened, right? You saw this moment. You waited. You're like, I can't wait for somebody to get in to this little space. And you just crafted that, you know, little shift to make sure that they're in that space exactly where you wanted them. Great stride you got of them. This yellow matches this, like all that. That's lucky or whatever, you know, you set yourself up for a really lucky moment, which is what a really good street photographer does, right? Is that they set themselves up for that moment. And it's not, it seems almost like an accident. Just happens to be there because you didn't direct this guy, right? That's not somebody you know. But at the same time, that moment was all of your crafting and you saw it before it happened. That's really good photography when it comes to event or street or anything that you don't have control over, is that you have to see it before it happens and then hope it happens so that you can, quote unquote, get lucky. But really what you're doing is you're setting yourself up for it. Which is different from model photography where you're directing everything. You're telling them what to do. You're telling them how to pose. And then if you don't nail it, it feels like you need to nail it. It needs to be above and beyond because you have control over the whole situation. And they, you know, as an artist are bringing whatever they bring to the table and you're giving what you're bringing to the table. So it needs to be a collaboration at the highest level. Otherwise you just miss the mark. So yeah, a few of those. We've got cats, pet photography. That is another difficult area because it's like trying to, you know, with an unpredictable event subject. With somebody, you know, at an event, you're like, oh, they're going to be on stage for a while. They're going to be going back and forth. They're probably going to sing. They're probably going to hold the mic. They're going to do this. There's pyrotechnics, maybe. Cats, you never know what they're going to do. They're unpredictable. So getting a good photo of a cat is really difficult. But you tried. You tried. And that's what counts. Good try. Yeah. Any other specific questions you might have, Bob? Anything else that you, you know, feel like you want to know about your work or, yeah, I don't know. It's cool that you're shooting all these people and it's awesome that you have access and you're there. I think that you should shoot more and you should shoot less event, not less event stuff, but you should shoot more stuff that isn't event stuff so that you can practice, so that when you are in an event situation, you can see that moment and how that light's going to affect it, you know? See how that's all going to happen before it happens. Yeah, that's super important. Like, access is cool, and it's awesome that you get access, but access should not be the reason your photo is better than, you know, other photos, if that makes sense. Cool. All right, Bhav, thanks for submitting. Next person. I am Alexi. All right, I am Alexi. Also, if you guys are in chat or hanging out here with us, let me know if you're in there watching right now. Otherwise, this VOD will be also up, so you can come back and watch the whole thing another time. But obviously, right now, you have a chance to ask me directly any questions you might have. Also, is this big enough for everyone? Can everybody see everything? I want to make sure you guys can see and you're able to. My hair is wild. I know my monitor is really big. Can see the image as well. Cool. Awesome. Thank you. Appreciate that, Sanchez. Spetty Sanchez. I want to make sure you guys can see everything. So we're rocking and rolling. The music in the background hopefully isn't too loud. All right. Next. Music is a little low, but I can hear it. Okay, I can turn it up a little bit. It's like low music. There we go. We'll leave it at 50%. All right, next we got I am Alexi. Okay, so here, again, a little more travel stuff. Very cool. Feels a little... Let me double check on this monitor, actually. I can see... a little less flat than it looks on this monitor, which is good. Okay, I would say this stuff is solid, but nothing stands out to me as unique. It feels like snapshots, you know. It's like you've traveled here, you took a photo snapshot. It didn't have any perspective necessarily. Maybe this one, you know, you start to get a little bit more story here. You've got your subject. But mostly these feel like snapshots that, you know, you maybe were walking and you're like, oh, that's cool. But what sets it apart from, you know, another person's shot? What makes yours different? And that's what I think you should focus on, is finding your voice. What you see is your perspective. Is it, you know, what about these places are you seeing? Like, compositionally, you know, it's there, but it's just not. And I think also your color grading and your kind of effects, you could definitely just lose some of the light leaks and things like that, unless you're shooting legitimately film. And just to start out with, I wouldn't focus on that so much, just so you can kind of develop your own composition. Kind of this stuff is just not helping your image. Like, it's making an okay image. You're like trying to make it a little cooler, and I've done the same thing, right? Where you're like trying to make it a little bit better, but really it just needs to be a stronger image to begin with, and then you don't have to worry about it. Trying to make it cooler, it'll just be cool on its own. This one's actually pretty cool. I like this one. I don't know where this is. December 6th, 2018. This is the last time you posted, but you, no, this was cool. So, I don't know, maybe it was less than a year ago, but a while ago. I would say focus on this. These colors are awesome. All right, cool. All right, let's double check and see if other people have submitted, just to be sure before we push on. Cool, okay, a few more people, but we might not be able to get to them. Let's see. All right. Cool. Next up, Sam Weimer, photographer, Los Angeles. Hey, he's local. Cool, I live in Los Angeles too. All right, Sam Weimer. Very cool. So, traveling around California, Oregon, Yosemite, you've got Lone Pine. That's cool. This is a cool image right here. That's a really cool image, actually. I like that one a lot. The colors, everything about this is, I really like that a lot. I think that this is the first one in your feed that stood out to me for sure. I'm just double checking on here. The contrast looks good. Yeah, it looks really good. Here we're blowing out the highlights again. Let me double check that it's not just my monitor. Okay, it's not. Yeah, this is definitely blown out. I guess you were going for something simple here, which is totally cool. These colors are nice. Let's see. So, I think coming to figure out what your composition is, be more intentional with your photos, I guess, is kind of the takeaway I'm seeing with some of these. That one shot of the guy laying down, this one feels very intentional. Feels like you plan to make sure that this was, you know, the same pattern, colors, his sweater matches, all that. Then you got this contrast here, and you've got this little piece of light, which is really cool. And then you've got his eyes popping out. Like, all that feels really great. Yeah, I'm going to even give that a like. I really like that image a lot. I think that in a lot of the other ones, it doesn't feel intentional. It feels like it's like a snapshot, but not quite there. Like, what's the composition here? You know, this, your eye is kind of in a weird non-1/3, or it's kind of in a strange spot. I think this feels intentional. You know, this guy and then this motion blur, that's cool. Feels a little more intentional. I think his head conflicting with this line is a bit off, but otherwise, you know, this leading line and this kind of corner and these straight line, like, this feels good overall. A lot of the lines there, I think your subject just kind of accidentally cut into that a little bit too much. This feels pretty intentional, but a little, that feels more intentional. This is a nice little moment. I think that we're losing a little bit of detail, but it's just kind of the way the light was. This feels intentional. This feels like you're trying, you know, I would actually love to see if there's more at the bottom here and more grass. Again, simplify. That would be a really cool image if it extended further down. And then that feels intentional. It's like you cut off the head in this, but you're really focused on the story here and this little like movement of this from the wind. That's super cool. That I think is a really good image. And you're not worried about their expression or who it is. It could be, it's timeless, right? Feels timeless. I think that a lot of these are similar in composition and kind of, you know, you're going for a lot of the same shots. I don't know if it's like literally the same shot or different focal lengths or like what it might be, but I would say try some new stuff, try some different stuff. These images are just too similar to me to be next to each other. A lot of bridge shots right here, unless that's what you're going for. But to me, it just feels like when I look at your feed overall, it's a lot of the same things right next to each other. And I think that you could diversify a little bit so that it felt like you had a breather from them. So here, you know, the composition is a bit muddy. You know, this kind of stuff detracts, I think, this construction from the subject. I know you were trying to go from a down the road shot, but I just don't know if it was, I don't know. This is kind of here. Just want to focus on simplifying your frame, getting rid of the things that don't belong and don't add to it. Just get rid of those so that you can focus and your subject and your, you know, your viewer can actually focus on the things that matter. But otherwise, I mean, the light is amazing and the colors, but that's Yosemite, you know, very, very cool there. Not sure what the story is on some of these. Compositionally, I think you could tell a little bit of a stronger story if it was compositionally a little bit stronger. So let's say, you know, just different shots, try different angles, you know, try that up straight up, try this in the background further, closer, more centered, over to the side, whatever it might be. Try some different stuff, mess around with your compositions, and I think you'll grow a lot from that. This is beautiful moment, but and compositionally it actually really works much better than a lot of your other images, because you got this and then your leading line comes to here and then comes, and this S curve is always a really nice, you know, if you got S curves and things in your photos, leading lines that lead your eye in but not in a straight line, kind of back and forth, it's a really keeps your audience's eyes moving across the frame. It's always really nice. So definitely think that's a strong composition compared to some of the other shots. Here again, this is, you know, conflicting with this piece. Not sure what all of this is, but it feels like conflicting. Doesn't feel cohesive. I think if you would have shifted to the right a little bit, maybe lost this foreground here or gotten closer to it and had this kind of sitting above this handle and this axe sitting above in this negative space, you could have created a more simple, cohesive image. But right now it looks just a little messy. So I'd focus on that. I'd focus on your composition for sure as your number one thing. And once you start to get that simple kind of making sure that your composition's solid, making sure you can focus on your subject or whatever your story is, then you're going to start to see a lot more improvement in your photography. Here, for instance, it's not quite centered. It's not quite reflected all the way. He's not quite, you know, it's all almost there. I think that if he was over here and then the whole image was centered around this little, you know, circle, imagine a circle here, and then he was a little bit back here, then that you'd have this, and that would feel really nice right in the center of the frame, maybe even down here, and then you have this negative space up top, whatever it might be. Just kind of focusing on that. How far am I down the queue? Thank you for the feedback. I appreciate it. Oh, cool. I'm glad you're watching, dude. Sam, you know, really glad that you submitted and glad that, you know, we can go through some of this stuff. And anytime, I'm glad that the feedback, hopefully it helps. Let me know if I can clarify anything or if it's making sense for you. You're next, Luke. How far am I down the queue? Yeah, you're next. You're actually up next. Sam, if you have any other questions about your work or anything I've said, this is a great image too. I think it's almost there. It's not quite perfect, but it's like if you would have shifted the lens a little bit to the left, like barely at all, it would have been right there, perfect, centered, everything. Whisper you the links. You can just post the links right here in chat, I think. I don't think I have a bot that deletes links, so you should be good. Go ahead and post it, and then I'll get to it. Or actually, yeah, whisper. So do you follow me? If you don't follow me on Instagram, right below, go check out my Instagram here, and then go to my story, and then right here on this one, you can type in exactly what you have. You can just type in there and I'll get it. That's the easiest way. So just go to my profile here, Ravi Vora. Go there.
What's up, guys?
Okay, and type so in there today I'm gonna do live on your review. On your phone. Sanchez. All right. So Sam, yeah. Again, I think this is your strongest image, and this feels intentional. Things like this start to feel more and more intentional. So definitely keep going on those, and you're gonna crush it for sure. Yeah. DGSC, thank you so much. Thank you for following. What's up, dude? Oh, Daniel, cool. Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for checking out my work. Commercial feedback helped a lot. Glad you liked it. I hope that it helped a lot. I hope it, you know, I think you have really strong work. You can keep pushing in that direction. And commercial work is one of those things where if you want to take your, you know, your style and elevate it to the next level, and clients, just, you don't want clients not to be able to use it. You want to make sure that they can use it for the campaign that they're doing, and they also want to use it for a longevity, and they want to be able to remember it. So just kind of knowing all those little things. I've been doing it for years now, so just kind of knowing what works and what doesn't work, it just helps a lot for sure. Cool. Feedback helped a lot. Thanks again. Have a great day. Of course, Sam. Thank you so much for stopping in, and I'm glad we could go over your stuff. All right. Next up, we've got Luke Skywatcher. Cool. Luke, you're here, right? You're here in chat. I think you're watching. We'll go through some of your stuff. Self-taught designer and photographer. Very cool. Yeah, awesome. Cool. Glad you're here. So let's take a look. A lot of travel photography. I like that. Love traveling. Places you've been look awesome. Very glowy. I would say that'd be one word I would describe your work. Very glowy. I think that clarity tool is your friend. In Lightroom. The colors are awesome. Love your overall aesthetic. It's very cohesive. And you've worked, I can tell, on, using this kind of landscape and then the small subject, kind of telling that story. It's pretty common in a lot of your shots, which I love to do personally as well. I'm sure you know that. Tells you, there's a great place, but also like, how do you experience it? And having that human interaction with your place is super cool. And I love that you've done it here. Arches, love this place. You're with Quinn. Awesome. I love Quinn. Quinn and Jess, very cool people. It's like you've hung out with some rad people. So that's always good too. Venturing with friends and people that you can learn from or shoot with, have a good time with is really cool. Hold on one second, guys. I'm going to just restart my webcam real quick because it needs a new battery. Thank you so much. Can't hear you. This wasn't down. Okay. Thanks, guys. New to streaming. I was saying that I have. I'm using my. You guys can hear me now, right? There we go. Okay, cool. I'm using my 5D right now, actually, Canon 5D, to stream with because I don't have a real webcam, so I have to switch the batteries out. But luckily, I've had, I've been on trips where I've had to go on a 5D with no ability to charge it for weeks on end. So I have four or five batteries. So I've just been switching it out whenever it needs it. And it's been working out so far. Quality's nice, but not the easiest or smartest solution if I want to do long streams. So I got hour and a half per battery about, which we've been, hour and 38 minutes. So exactly an hour and a half per battery is not too bad. I'm not going to worry about it just yet. Cool. Y'all are here. We can hear everything. All right. So I love this spot. Super cool. Love the color. You get really great light. You shoot at the right times of day. You know, I know you probably enhance your, you know, a lot of radial tool going on, which is awesome. Looks great still. I think that it looks like, are you doing a lot of commercial work, or are you mostly doing, yeah, it looks like, okay, so you're doing some commercial ad work. Introducing some portraiture. Nice. I can see that you don't do a ton of portraiture, at least it doesn't look like, but you're introducing some, trying to diversify a little bit more of your kind of, right now a lot of this feels very cohesive, which is awesome. And you know, the colors, the subject, a lot of the stuff looks very much more like you're shooting a lot of the same kind of stuff, but obviously it's awesome stuff. You're getting great engagement. I think that trying new subjects matter is going to help you a lot. Doing more portraiture, doing more, you know, different things than if you always have, like, for instance, right? It's almost hard to take a bad photo in a place like this with great light, great sunset, great colors, simplicity, all that stuff, right? It's difficult. So if you put yourself in the shoes of a lot of commercial photographers, they have to go to places and take photos in places that there isn't a good shot. There's just no good shot there, pretty much. It feels that way, right? You don't have this epic backdrop. You don't have this amazing landscape and scale and all that kind of stuff. You also have to shoot a subject that is a box of cereal like Daniel was doing, or you have to shoot, you know, whiskey, or you have to shoot clothes or something that isn't as easy, isn't aesthetically as easy to put two and two together. So how do you do that? You know, what do you start to integrate? How do you do it? And I think that if you want to move into more commercial work and you want to get more, you know, bigger paid jobs like that, you have to try to push yourself to shoot when you don't have anything to shoot and don't have a shot. And then you'll start to figure out how to make angles work, and you turn one beautiful shot or one beautiful place into, you know, some amazing details and portraits and light coming through here and just the different things. I know that, you know, just to bring up my work really quickly, you know, I love shooting landscapes and things, stars or whatever, and cars and all these things for clients. But then I also love to shoot, you know, this detail stuff where it's like, okay, there's a subject and colors, but you might not have, like, where is this as far as like landscape wise? You don't have this epic landscape to shoot. So I've learned that through having to shoot in a lot of different ways with my projects. Like here, right? I didn't have an epic place to shoot, but I did have colors that matched the subject and the wardrobe. So I specifically chose, you know, this bag right here and this specific coloring and this, you know, all that stuff cohesively together is super, you know, that's what I wanted, to still capture a really great image, even though I didn't have, you know, this is a dirty bridge in New York City. Like, that's not beautiful by itself, but it has that grit, it has something to it. So how do you integrate what you're shooting, this premium, you know, luxury brand, and how do you integrate it? So I think that's something that would help you, you know, move beyond just landscapes, just these kind of the similar shots. And nothing wrong with that, of course, very beautiful work. But if you want to diversify, if you want to get in more commercial work, don't call the Williamsburg Bridge dirty. It is absolutely dirty. There is garbage everywhere, dirt. It's disgusting. But that's kind of the beauty of New York. That's what we love about it, is it's got that grit. What are your favorite lenses to shoot commercial work with? Do you think that type of work should only be shot with primes? Okay, I mean Manhattan. Well, first of all, you don't even know which bridge. You called this the wrong bridge, so automatically I can't take you seriously. That's embarrassing that you live in New York. Okay, favorite lenses to shoot commercial work. It really depends on the project, to be honest. I think primes, if you can get away with it, if it's a setup, you know, and you're shooting it, I think primes always are the way to go. But if you're a little more run and gun, discovering what you're doing, don't have so much time, then yeah, you can get away with a really nice sharp, let's say 2470, 1635, 7200, any of those, super, really, really great, at least with Canon. Again, I shoot Canon, I shoot with this little guy, this little Sony, but I don't shoot Nikon, I don't really shoot with the Sony, the other Sonys, the Alpha series. I've shot with them before, but don't really shoot them too much. And so I can't really speak to those. But with the Canon stuff, the primes are great. The even the Sigma primes are great. And some of the other Tamrons and things like that. You can find great lenses between those. And then I shoot, you know, Phase 1 and Hasselblad, and they have amazing lenses as well with a much more medium format quality to them. So I would say find what you like to shoot, how you like to shoot, and you'll really start to, you know, challenge yourself. The other day, or the other week, I guess, I challenged myself to only shoot with a certain prime lens for a bunch of different stuff and see where I could, you know, discover different angles and things and force myself to, you know, try that rather than having an easy 24-70 or something like that to switch back and forth between. Do you think that type of work should only be shot with primes? So yeah, to answer your question, no, they don't have to only be shot with primes, but I think that shooting with primes will give you that little boost in quality, depending on what you're shooting again. Sometimes the aesthetic is that film quality, like kind of a more lo-fi look, and you want a lens that actually doesn't go down to 1.4, doesn't go that low. You want something that goes to, you know, only to 4 or 5.6 or even 8, and that's the look. It all depends on what you're shooting and what your vibe is. Favorite lenses to shoot commercial work with? Again, just to reiterate, there's a lot of them, a lot of different. It all depends on the. I don't like the pinhole, like what I do or what I like to shoot with necessarily. I like to learn the range and know exactly what I need. I say, oh, this is, you know, I see this kind of look. I want to get that look. I want to do this. I shoot with that lens. With film or video work, rather, a lot of times I'll stick to a little bit wider, maybe like a 35 to 50 range in there. And that's like my favorite look, but that's all dependent on, you know, some people like a longer lens or a wider lens, like a 14 with some of the films that Chivo, Emmanuel Lubitsky, he is a cinematographer that I think is probably the best working right now. And I love his wide stuff. So it really depends on everyone's personal taste. Jake Cure, what's up, dude? Thank you for following. Welcome to the stream. I hope you're having a great day. I'm tired, bro. Been up since 5 a.m. Oh, well, that is early over there, because that's another 3 hours. Go-tos. Have you ever tried shoot skin tone with Sony? Thoughts. yeah, I have tried to shoot skin tone with Sony. I shot a campaign, a couple campaigns with the Sony, and I think with some work, it gets there, but it's not the same as out of the camera with Canon. I don't know. Canon just has a certain texture to it, a certain quality of color that is just, it's just amazing. So I really love the way Canon looks. It looks like you probably shoot Canon based on your profile picture. Can't really tell what that is. It looks like a Canon with a 24-70 or a Sony. I can't tell. but yeah, shoot Sony. Okay, cool, dude. Yeah, skin tones on Sony, are you not feeling super strong about them? I mean, it has a digital quality to it, for sure, in this shot at least. Might also be your processing. I'm not sure if you feel comfortable with them or they're different, but I think that the digital quality for sure is apparent. But that also is probably because you're coming from the same preset you're using or the same kind of color space that you would shoot, you know, a landscape, and then you're kind of going into here, which is totally fine, but you just have to kind of figure out what fits for you. Lo-fi is legit. I just can't do it. Yeah, it's definitely a vibe. You have to feel the emotion. The emotion is way more important than the quality of the image, to be honest. It's like, what is the emotion? If you can draw the emotion out, that's the only thing that matters. Nothing else matters almost. It can be the shittiest photo. It can be the like just the worst lighting and everything else. But if you get that emotion, you get that moment, you get that rawness, that's what that's about for sure. Which I think is actually really cool, because to me, emotion is one of the most important things, if not the most important thing when it comes to photography. This to me is like just cool emotionally, like these two shots, right? That's shot on a GoPro. That's nothing fancy at all. Like a GoPro shooting stuff, I think is totally fine if you can get away with it, because you captured a moment, you captured emotion, you captured, you know, this kind of stuff just gives you that feeling. It's not about perfect shot, perfect, you know, depth of field and all that. It's about what's your, you know, what you're getting out of it. So, yeah. Only asking as those commercial projects were shot in 1635 and the distortion was heavy, but I recently purchased a 24 1.4 and shot more work, and that feels, looks a lot nicer. Yeah, so Daniel, I, like I was saying, yeah, I could tell it was 1635, but the 24, I think you're gonna like that a lot. The 1.4, again, there is distortion on that. I think once you get to 35, 50 and up, you start to lose all that distortion, especially at 50. 35, you have a little distortion, but not much. And yeah, you can kind of fix that in post. But yeah, at 16 and kind of wider than 24, you start to see it a lot. And it can get you in trouble unless you know where to place your subject. For instance, let's see, even with portraits, especially with portraits, I shoot 24-70 a lot because it's just easier to shoot sometimes. So we'll get into the situations. This is 24-70, but you know, you choose an in-between focal length instead of just going one or the other. This is with a 35 mil, you know, this kind of stuff is, it all depends what you're shooting, you know, what you're trying to get out of it. This is 24-70. I shot this for this movie. This is all 20. Actually, this is 1530. So this is actually even wider. But because of where I put the subject and where I knew, you know, what I was going to crop, it doesn't feel distorted, even though it's at probably 15 mil at this. Like, that's even wider than your lens goes. And that's the way I framed it. I knew that I wasn't gonna catch anything that was like going to be distorted, so I just knew where to, you have to know where to place your subject, how to place it, what's getting distorted. You look in the lens and you'll start to see, you know, what parts kind of need to be you need to worry about, because otherwise, if it's smooth sand, for instance, right, like this is not, it doesn't matter if this is distorted, you're not going to tell because it's just lines. But if your subject is near the edge in the corner, then you're going to start to see and notice the difference. And you're going to see like a little bit of distortion, but because this is coming almost straight from the lens, you don't notice the distortion as much. These trees, you see a little bit of it, a little bit stretching, but it's like not that bad. But yeah, and here you definitely start to see some distortion, but it's kind of like, that's the look, that's the thing we're going for. So, but the subject isn't distorted, and that's pretty important. Shoot Sony, do you like those too cooked on skin tones? Oh, these right here, huh? Too cooked on skin tones. I don't think they're too cooked necessarily. It just feels digital. These are the only portraits I see in your work right now, so I can't really give you too much feedback. If you have more portraits, I could probably give you a little more feedback. So for instance, there's a lot of different, you know, skin tones that you can play with and start to see how it all kind of goes together. These are different cameras. This is Blake Griffin. I just shoot with him, and you know, you start to see the different skin tone, but it doesn't feel that digital. It feels a little more filmic just because of the quality of light and everything. Again, you look through the skin tones here, you start to see it's not cooked. It's not crushed. It's you've got every single skin tone that these girls have there, it's there. Even these, like, a little desaturated, but you know, we're not losing the texture quality of the skin. It's not, you know, retouched to oblivion. It's there. Here's a little grittier kind of stuff. This beat stuff, I think, is a good example of skin tone and how to kind of maintain it throughout the image. You don't lose it, not a lot of heavy retouching or anything like that, and you still keep, you know, different. Nat Young, yeah, that's exactly who that is, Nat Young. Yeah, I did a shoot with him in Santa Cruz, and I don't know if that's where you're from, but yeah, Nat Young, he's really nice. We went to, what's it called? It's like a place where the water like pushes up through this thing. I think they call it the toilet bowl or something, and it like flushes out. It's pretty hilarious. But yeah, we were doing some surfing that day. What do you think of the new RF lenses, 28 to 70 f2, etc.? Have you thought about moving to the R system? I have not thought about moving to the R system yet. I think that they're still early on in their mirrorless systems. I think I see some, you know, work from my friends, and I think it's cool that they're moving there, but I don't, it's not leaps and bounds yet to the point where I feel like it, like I need to start considering it. It's just, it's got a lot more fleshing out to do, and I think they're in the kind of early stages of it. And I mean, even with the first alpha, Sony alphas, I think they're doing leaps and bounds better than, you know, before. But when the first alpha came out, they weren't super into it, right? Not everybody was like, we have to have it. And now, you know, Sony's taking over the photography game, which is awesome. Yeah, so it's been great to see the landscape of camera manufacturers change and everything else. They're lacking in the mirrorless game. Fuji and Sony have that locked down. Yeah, they do right now. I agree they have it locked down, but I don't think that's a forever thing. I think that's going to be one of those things that I mean, Canon's huge. Everybody loves their color space. It's a matter of, like, look at this little alfalfa thing I got going on. Sorry, I got distracted by seeing it. Not forever, but they're so far behind. Yeah, they're far behind, but Canon color space, again, I don't know. So I've shot with every brand except for Nikon, because I just haven't, but I shoot with Phase 1, so which one was Phase? This was all shot on the Phase 1, and yeah, the color is much closer to Canon, or the skin tone and everything is much closer to Canon, and it's just so nice. Like, I love the way the skin tone comes out of the Phase 1. It's really, really beautiful. And then here's the Canon. So the Canon is much warmer, much smoother, kind of oranges, and I think that it just comes out super nice. And then let's see, which one is these? Some of these are Sony. This one's Sony, I think. Yeah, this is Sony, I think. Sony, yeah. I don't remember which one, the R, I think. I don't know, it just feels more digital, even though, like, there's cool moments and things, but it just did, even when I was shooting it, I felt like it was more that I had to do to not make it feel digital. A lot more detail, but I think that was almost, I don't know, just didn't have my favorite feeling, and I still want to check out Sony's systems. Let's see, what else was Sony? This was Sony, which was, again, really cool and turned out really well, but yeah, actually this is Sony as well. So it really depends how you edit, and you just kind of figure out what you like to do and how you like to shoot it. This is Canon, so I don't know. This is Canon, you know, this is the look. Is there a way to get more of a film look on Sony, sharpness down? Well, Luke, I mean, you're already doing it, right? You're turning that clarity down. You're turning, you know, trying to take that sharpness out. I don't know if it's the sharpness, but if you look at, let's say, look at her hand right there, right? That just looks filmic in the Canon system versus the Sony system, which, I don't know. There's just something that it's like the imperfection is what gives it that feeling, that imperfection, right? Her hand is, that's just motion blur, but it's like, it's so good. It's technical in the Sony stuff versus, like, we're looking at, instead of this imperfection, this grain, this kind of feeling, you're feeling the image more in the Canon stuff and the Phase stuff. Even the Hasselblad sometimes, like, it's really interesting seeing the differences in skin tones and color. What do I have that's Hasselblad? I actually have a bunch of stuff from Yosemite that I didn't post from Hasselblad, the Hasselblad stuff. I took the X1D out. Hasselblad lent it to me. How long ago was it? A while ago. This, I believe. Let's see. This is Hasselblad. Yeah, it was a rainy one. Okay, this is rainy, I remember. This is Hasselblad. No, this is Canon. Oh, sorry. That one was a time lapse. Hasselblad. This is Hasselblad. So this is Hasselblad X1D, which I think actually was super nice. I mean, obviously the environment helped a lot, but the way, just the creaminess, the like purpley greens and everything. This is Hasselblad as well. Just the way the colors came out was super Hasselblad. Yeah, it was just really nice filmic quality to it. That was Canon. This is Hasselblad. And I think there's a lot of things you can do. Every camera manufacturer is a little different, but you find what works for you, and you start to really develop your technique. And yeah, this is Canon. So it's a little more digital looking, I think. It all depends on what you're going for. Even your edits can be a little different, right? So like, your subject matter, your edits, everything kind of plays into it. It doesn't matter always what you shoot on so much as finding that kind of simplicity in that frame. And then you get that glow from light, the quality of light, and this is natural, or you're in a situation where the quality of light's different. This is, my friend shot this, and this was on Tony. So he, you know, doesn't feel fully, and this is on Canon at the same night. So I shot this of my hand and he shot that of me. So it all depends on, you know, your environment a lot more than it does the camera itself. This was shot on Hasselblad. This is a Hasselblad image. So this is medium format, which is really, really cool because I can blow this up pretty big. But all this stuff's on Canon, and yeah, gets the job done. Whatever you feel comfortable with, even drone. I mean, you'd see a drone shot and you're just like, wow, that looks dope. It doesn't matter that it was a drone. It was a tiny little camera with a tiny little sensor. What matters is the fact that you got that angle, you got that shot, and that's way more important than anything else. Especially with the quality, you know, quality of the image and everything. So this is a drone shot, and I feel like a drone shot here is worth, you know, way more. Underwater GoPro, like, what? A GoPro shot. That's, you're not gonna get any other camera under there unless you have a whole system set up to take it underwater. How do you feel about the current state of Instagram? What do you mean? You could be a little more specific than that. Maybe I can help answer, or yeah, what do you mean by that? I'd love to give any feedback, but it's more specifically, what do you mean? Like the way it looks, the way it feels, the way the community is, I don't know. And even then, like all sorts of different, you know, stuff we're doing, trying stuff. Also, we're at the 2-hour mark, I think. Let me double check while I have a moment here to see if anybody else responded. Okay, cool. Spetty, you sent it through. Spetty Sanchez. Sweet, hold on. Let me pull that up. All right, we'll do two more, and then I think we're going to call it on the portfolio review. All right. What's your favorite camera to shoot with? You've had a ton of experience with many brands. Again, I don't really have a favorite per se. My personal systems are the Canon systems, so I have a 1D and I have a 5D. So I love those. I love Canon systems, but I would say I also love the phase systems. And the only thing is that if you're using a phase system, it just is a lot to lug around. The Hasselblad systems are great too. With the smaller, you know, X1D, I think is great. And I think once they develop that a little bit more and keep pushing it, I honestly think that might be my go-to over one of the Sony mirrorless, because it's a medium format mirrorless. You know, that just, why not? That's pretty rad to have a 100 megapixel camera in your pocket if you want to take, you know, take that big of an image over, what is it now, 60, 68, 70 megapixels on the Sony. It's, I don't know, the RX, whatever, the new one. It's crazy. It's actually insane. The algorithm, engagement dropping, etc. Honestly, it's hard to really look. If Instagram's your only thing and you're just there for the engagement and all that, like, you have to just love what you do. Just love what you do. Love creating. Love the craft and focus on that and bring that to, you know, continue to use that and continue to do what you love to do. And it doesn't matter what the platform is. If Instagram goes away, it goes away. And if your engagement goes away, it goes away. And if whatever, like, love what you do and find new ways to do it and adapt to whatever. And you'll always thrive, because people will see that passion. And if you're really good at something, it doesn't matter what the platform is. It doesn't matter if it's, you know, the engagement goes away and everything else, you're going to find other ways to thrive. And just love and keep creating what you love to create and be the artist that you want to be. I wouldn't worry about engagement. Post what you want to post, share what you want to share, and people will either want that and come to you for that, or, you know, you'll find a new audience for it, and that's your voice. And you're not going to, you don't change it just because someone or something is changing. Because something that, you know, you just look at patterns and market yourself in a way and adapt. Hope that answered your question. For instance, this photo here, I took this before I had an Instagram, before I even knew, well, maybe I had an Instagram, but I wasn't using it for photography. I wasn't using it. Like, I took this image for a commercial job that, like, I got hired to do as a creative director. And I was like, all right, cool. I want to take photos of something really cool. So, I directed that. We actually wet down it's a private jet company. And we wet, you know, I had a truck come in and put water down, and we got really lucky with the sunset. And I was like, this is awesome. And I can still use this today to any platform that comes along. I can create and, you know, share. And if there's another platform, Instagram goes away or whatever, I can still use this, and I can put this in a book and send it to a client, and there's no, you know, it's not like that changes. The art is still there. You know what I mean? That sunrise, sunset is ridiculous. Too easy with that. If it was that easy. Yeah, but I had to position this. We had to clean this. We had a crew of so many people. It's like insane. Got super lucky for sure. And, you know, having a water truck on hand, and I said, okay, go wet this down, a movie water truck. We just got really lucky with the sunset that night for sure. But set us up, like I was saying earlier, set yourself up to be lucky by seeing it. Either way, if it had just been no clouds at all and just a sunset, it still would have been a solid image. Actually, even maybe even easier and more commercial, because you wouldn't have had all this distraction. You would have had a clean sky, and they could put copy in the sky. Dude, it was a huge water truck. Movie water truck. Like, these things. Like, one of these huge things. And you literally spray the water all over, and you wet down the ground of a private airport. And this is the same airport that they filmed, like, Christopher Nolan was shutting down to film Inception and all these other movies here in Van Nuys. So it was, like, pretty huge, and you spray it down, and then you just have this wet ground, and you can create your reflection as if it just rained, but it didn't rain at all. So production value was very high on that photograph for sure. Private jet that costs x number of lots of money and jet fuel and everything else to put it where I needed it to be, and then this. It was very high budget. But yeah, what was I gonna say about? I think there was another question that I was gonna answer. Favorite camera to shoot with? No, okay. Yeah, so yeah, skin tone stuff. Just look through, see stuff that you might find that works. Again, there's lots of stuff I haven't posted that I need to post. I'm so far back on edits, it's kind of insane. Stuff that before I had Instagram, before I like cared about it and everything, was sharing and creating photography all over. So yeah, it's not one of those things that you just do because you're getting good engagement. It's something you just do because you love to do it and you love the aspect of creating art. And if you're successful at a platform, that means that platform connects with whatever you're doing, but that doesn't mean that you're not creating your art. That makes sense. Cool. Let me double check again to make sure that this is it. We'll do two more portfolios and then we'll be done for the reviews. All right. Cool. Next up is Sergio. All right. You still here, dude? Spetty. Oh, man. He's up. All right. Let's see what we got here. Picks by Sergio. Sergio, Canon Fuji Vibe Chaser, Chicago, Illinois. Chicago. Cool. I'm actually from Michigan, so I know the weather over there is righteous. excuse me. All right, so Vibe Chaser. All right, so looks like you're into makeup, costumes, portraiture, Halloween, a little bit more of a horror vibe. I'm a little terrified looking at your work. That's gonna be my first impression, is that I'm scared. Just going back, sometimes I like to go back and see where people came from, what they like to do before they kind of fell into their niche. Looks like portraiture kind of always been your thing. Like shooting kind of tattoos or makeup. Do you do makeup or do you just like to shoot it? Or do you know people that do it, or what's the story here? Oh wait, isn't that? It's Elizabeth, yeah, I know Elizabeth. I've met her a few times here in LA. I have a team for makeup, but I use on the reg. Okay, right on. Cool. So do you come up with concepts for these shoots? Do people come to you and say that? Like, what's the process here? Just so I know kind of what I'm looking at. Mostly come up with the concepts, and then sometimes I'll collab with makeup artists or the model. Cool. And then it's all just your own art, or does it, you know, go somewhere outside of this? Do people, you know, are they looking for this kind of work? Is that your baby? Or your friend's baby? Okay. That's adorable. As a market for the scary. Okay, cool. All right, so I would say you're obviously doing an amazing job with the makeup and everything else and scary aspects. Nailed that. Promo companies and such, okay? Yeah, nailed that. I'm terrified of all of this for sure. I think that, you know, crushing your black or fading your blacks, maybe not. Like this kind of vibe right here, this more high detail stuff, pushes you more into the commercial realm, but not necessarily, you know, the crushed blacks and stuff. That's terrifying. So I would say just focus on a little more diversity, maybe the details, and then show the story. And it looks a little, it looks makeup-y. I don't know if that's what you want or not, but I would go for a little less, more like more retouching in the vein of maybe less obvious that it's just makeup and less obvious that it's, you know, that, and make it more cinematic, you know, start introducing more elements, have people have lights, have sets, have, you know, a little more atmosphere, back up away from your subject a little bit more, and then maybe you can, you know, then push in, that kind of thing. So change it up a little bit, I would say, you know, not all the same. Like, I don't know, this is probably old, but for instance, you know, all of these feel like they're the same distance, the same subject, same lighting, almost same composition, everything, right? Change it up, switch it up, try some new stuff, experiment, think about stories, think about taking someone out in the woods and, you know, shooting the werewolf man, maybe stuff like that. Cool. All right. Thanks for submitting, Sergio. Appreciate it. All right. Last one. We've got Raisa Mukadam. Hold on. Let me back. Yeah, does that make sense to you, dude? I'm hoping that that's pretty straightforward, but not necessarily like, for sure. Okay, cool. Yeah, I think that if you just focused on that, did a little bit more in that vein, you'll end up with more of the surroundings, not so close. Yeah, so story, right? Like, look at the story, look what you can do with it, and then make it about, you know, look at a good film, right? A good horror film isn't just close-ups of the monster all the time. Isn't always like that. It's you gotta build the ambiance, gotta build the, yeah, incorporate the surroundings, incorporate a, you know, more environment and things like that, for sure. A good horror film does more than just show you only the you know, close-up of a scary monster or scary person or whatever. It does more than that. All right, let's see what else we got going on here. All right, 6 viewers in chat. What's up, guys? Everybody in chat, thank you for hanging out, by the way. Hope you're having a great time learning and or just being able to kind of see what's going on. Again, my Instagram, if you guys ever want to, you know, go through, check it out, feel free. There's a lot of different things to kind of go over today, and it's gonna be, you know, it's a long 2 hours of going over portfolios and talking about people's photography, so I'm glad we could do this today. Raisa, Arkansas. Okay. Looks again a lot more snapshotty, I would say. Just focus on, you know, maybe stuff more like this, right? Where you're starting to craft images, come up with compositions, colors. Yeah, just get out there, shoot more. Try some more stuff that isn't just snapshots. Try to really focus on what the story is in your subject. Crafting your composition. There's something here. There's some starting to get some places, I think, but I would say, yeah, like this. You're starting to find a story. Like, what is, you know, you're trying to figure out what's going on here. Find your story. Find your moments, and I think you're gonna start to be less snapshotty. And find your voice. Yeah. Cool. All right. Anybody else in chat have any other questions before we end this section of the stream? If not, I may switch over to play some games for a little bit. But yeah. All right. All right. Thank you guys for hanging out. I'm glad you were able to see some of the behind the scenes, or talk about, you know, what the work is and how it affects different things, what you can do to improve, what you need to change things. And I'm hoping that, you know, that helps your entire process yourselves. And if you, you know, incorporate some of that, I think that you guys will grow. And hopefully we can do another one of these streams. If you guys liked it, definitely let me know. Hit me up on Twitter, on Instagram. It's all down below here. And make sure you subscribe or follow so you can know when I go live next.